Good evening, and thank you for coming. And I'd like to thank everyone at BayPath for inviting me back to come and speak at the Kaleidoscope series. My purpose tonight is to provide some guidance for helping you help your students with the college, with their college search. Show of hands, how many of your students are juniors? Okay, so we're mostly juniors and sophomores. Okay, got it. We have anyone else? Freshmen, seniors? I know we have a. No? Okay, great. Just gives me an idea of how to focus this. I know this, you know, especially this is a very busy time of year for everyone, and for juniors especially, you know, very busy, very stressful time of year. They're going through, you know, maintaining, they're, you know, concerned with maintaining good grades because this year is, you know, viewed very carefully by colleges. They're focused on their SATs and ACTs, they've got their extracurriculars, their sports, their clubs, everything going on all at once. And on top of all that, this is the time of year for juniors, especially where college planning has kicked into high gear. Time is precious, stress levels are high, and as parents, it's a very difficult position for you to be in because you want to be there to help them, but you don't want to stress them out anymore. Am I right in feeling this out a little bit? Tonight, I'd like to give you some pointers on how you can help your children navigate the college selection process in a productive and successful way while keeping those stress levels to a minimum. First, a lot of you may be asking yourselves whether or not you should get involved in the college selection process at all. To that, I answer an unequivocal yes, get involved. There are hundreds, there are thousands of different types of institutions of higher learning out there. You know, if this it seems daunting and overwhelming to you, imagine how it must be to your students, how it must feel to your children. School counselors are a terrific source of support and guidance, but they have a lot on their plates. And in large public schools, there's a large student to counselor ratio. And I'd like to refer to an article that just appeared a couple of months ago in the New York Times. Actually, it appeared on Christmas Day, interesting time. And it reads, the title of the article was Little College Guidance. And it says, while small private schools can often afford to provide their students with tremendous hand-holding, large public schools across the country, by the way, is my voice okay? Is it, am I too close? I'm good? Okay. Large public schools across the country struggle with staggering ratios of students to guidance counselors. Nationally, that ratio is nearly 500 to 1. And when it comes to a time to apply to college, all of the students need help at once. And in some schools, there's nothing. The Federal Education Department's Office for Civil Rights said this year that 1 in 5 schools in the country had no school counselor at all. When it comes time to apply to college, students who are insufficiently counseled can easily stumble into making poor decisions, especially if no one in their family has gone to college before. Just an interesting article. I'm not saying that this is going to happen at your school, but typically where there's a high, you know, student to counselor ratio, I would say that would be a great reason, a great support reason to get involved with your the student with this process with your student. Okay, two things that I want you to remember. Number one, parents play a critical role in successful college planning. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Just go with that, trust me. Number two, how you handle your involvement is extremely important, and I'll explain what I mean by that in a few moments. Two important thoughts I hope you take away with you when you leave here tonight are balance and fit, and I'd like to discuss balance for a moment. College planning can be a very stressful, a very time-consuming process, and you'll have to set aside a considerable amount of time of your own, to, you know, your own time to be helpful, supportive, and realistic. While you want to let your children drive this process, you should also be there to guide them through it and to make sure they stay on track, and that's where you need to strike the right balance. Helping them research colleges online is great. Taking them on campus visits to information sessions and so forth, that's all great. Just let them take the lead. Gotta find the balance. And as far as fit, you'll hear me using that word a lot tonight. Oops, did I go too far? Helping your child find the right college fit is more important than helping him find the most prestigious college. Don't force your child to apply to a school just because it's highly ranked on U.S. News and World Report. Don't force your child to apply to a school because you're an alum of that school. Don't force them because they have, you know, a sibling, excuse me, a sibling, I'm gonna need my water, a sibling going to that school, don't force them because you have friends. It's all about the journey and figuring out what the best fit for them is. With hundreds and hundreds of great schools out there, there will be a variety that will appeal to the needs and interests of your children. The key is to find out what those needs and interests are and to help them identify the schools that will enable them to succeed. That's really what it's all about. As a parent, you have three important jobs when it comes to helping your child find the right fit. And if you picked up, everybody's got a copy of the handout now, right? You'll see on the second page, what I've done is, just to give you a brief, maybe I'll go through the handout very quickly. If you turn to page two, I don't want anyone feeling like they have to take a whole bunch of notes. I don't want you feeling like you have to do every single thing on this list. What I'm providing for you today is just a menu of things for you to think about as you're helping your child with this process. So on the second page, the three things I'm going to cover are that you need to communicate with your child, and I'll go through all those things below there briefly. The second is to provide support for them. And the third is to set realistic expectations. As we have the handout in our hand, let me just take you through that real quickly. If you turn to page three, there are a list of college navigation websites, everything from directing you where to go to sign up for standardized testing, to how to get college information, and how these college websites have applications that enable you to, or enable your student to sort of hone in on colleges based on their needs, preferences, and interests. There's financial aid websites and college application websites. The fourth and the fifth pages are questionnaires that I give to students, but I thought I'd extract some of these questions and just provide them in this package for you, just to give you an idea of some of the ways that you can sort of get their interest going and get them thinking in a way that they're not used to thinking. And then it goes on for college tours, questions to ask on the college tours, rest of the packet. I made this a very comprehensive packet. Campus safety questions, and finally ending with the common application essay prompts. Yes, these are the ones for 2015, 2016 for those of you who have juniors. Okay, so that's all that's in this package. So the three tasks, as we said, are to communicate, provide support, and set realistic expectations. There we go. They're just going to get stuck on me. Communication. Communication is more than just sitting down and talking to your student. It's empowering them to look inward, guiding them to determining what they think is the best learning environment for them. You can start by asking them questions about their interests, their passions, their goals. What are their favorite classes? Why are those their favorite classes? Is it because they're able to interact with the teacher? Is it because they have a little more freedom in this class? Encouraging them to answer these questions will help them focus on the things that are important to them in their learning, and it'll get them thinking in a way that they're not used to thinking. Now, I'm going to take it back to the handout. I'm sorry, I'm going back and forth here. But just to give you an idea of some of the questions that I have the students answer, page four. Discuss the size of your school. It gives them an idea. Are they comfortable in their school? Do they feel like their high school is a little too large for them? Do they wish it was smaller? Question five, when it comes to academic subjects like math, science, English, foreign language, history, which are their strongest? Which are their most challenging? And then I like to take it to question six. Putting grades aside, which of these subjects do you enjoy most? They may be getting a C in biology, but who knows? Maybe that's their favorite subject. So it's a good way to get them thinking in a way that they're not used to. Were you going to say something, Brianna? Oh, okay. The second part of that, career interests and personal skills, down at the bottom of page four. I ask them to look at the careers of people around them, friends, families, neighbors, and others in their community. Do any of those careers appeal to them? Again, that gets them start thinking about, honing in on possible majors, areas of interest, types of institutions of greater learning they'd like to go to. If they could work at any job for a day, what would that job be? And why would they choose that job? Okay, and again, on page five, the personal criteria for college selection, That I usually ask them to do after I've given this presentation, just to see what things are important to them once I present them with the factors that they should consider. Everybody with me so far? Yeah, okay. Okay, so that's communication. Communication, the different types of learning institutions. Technical and vocational schools. These are institutions that offer specialized programs that prepare students for a specific trade or industry. They're worth considering if your student is focused on specific careers like the culinary arts, healthcare technology, accounting, computer technology, and auto repair, and so forth. Some schools specialize in only one area, while others provide a wide variety of programs. They can award diplomas, certificates, licenses, and sometimes associate's degrees and bachelor's degrees. Community colleges, also known as junior colleges, these offer two-year programs where one can earn an associate's or a liberal arts degree. They're a great option for a lot of students because they're close to home, so they can save money on traveling and on commuting and on housing. Tuition is very low because they receive public tax dollars at the local, state, and federal levels. They design their two-year programs so that a lot of students can transfer after going to a community college for 2 years. And it's a way for families to save a considerable amount of money. Go to community college for 2 years, and then move on to, you know, the last 2 years, your junior and senior year would be completed at a college or a university. Universities. Oh, do I have that in order? Yes, universities. Universities tend to be large schools that offer a wide variety of four-year programs. They can be public schools like the University of Massachusetts, University of Connecticut. They could be private schools. They may have several undergraduate and graduate schools and colleges. And, you know, what a lot of students don't realize, it's interesting, when sometimes I work with students at the end of the process when they're working on their actual applications, and they don't realize when they're applying to a large university that you actually, in a lot of cases, have to apply to a specific school at that university. And it comes down to that, and it's like, well, do you want to apply to, you know, the School of Engineering, or do you want to apply to the School of Arts and Sciences, or do you want to apply to the business school? And it actually comes down to that point at the end when they're ready to fill in the application, and they just didn't realize that. So important for your students to be aware of that. The undergraduate schools at universities award bachelor's degrees, usually a Bachelor of Arts, Bachelor of Science, upon completion of the 4 years. Colleges tend to be smaller than universities, although as I'm saying that, there are some colleges that are parts of universities, there are colleges that are larger than some universities. So everything I say, there's another way of looking at it. Four-year colleges offer bachelor's degrees. Graduate degrees may or may not be offered at a college. The size of the class and the types of social opportunities will vary from college to college. A college may be public or private, an independent institution, or as I said, part of a larger university. And then we have online degrees. I feel like I'm echoing. I'm not too close? Okay. Online degrees offer an excellent option for busy individuals who want to earn a degree but find it difficult to fit a fixed class schedule into their own schedules, their own lives. But there are a number of benefits to online degrees. They can attend classes at a time that's convenient for them. They can complete coursework from a number of locations. No cost for commuting or housing. Many schools from which to choose. Many degree options and access to financial aid programs. Talk to your children. Ask the thought-provoking questions like the one I have included in the handout. And decide what type of institution is best for them. Uh-oh, there we go. Next is location. Important thing to communicate with your children. I can't tell you how many times it gets to the end of the line, and I hate to see students send out an unbelievable number of applications, a ridiculous amount, to be honest with you, and they're applying to schools that they never know they'll attend. Think about location. Some parents will put restrictions on their kids and say, I don't want you traveling more than 2 hours from home. Do they want to be close to the home? Do they want to be in a commute from home? Do they want to be, you know, 3 hours, 5 hours from home? Do they want to be across the country? Something they need to consider. Setting. What kind of setting? Would they like an urban, suburban, or rural setting? Advantages to each kind, and they need to spend some time there to really get a feeling for what they think they're best suited for. You know, something like an urban setting, sometimes the colleges and universities are contained within one area, sometimes they're spread out over the entire city. Great advantages to an urban setting because you can take learning outside the classroom. Say you're a theater major at a particular university in a city. Well, guess what? There's the theater at your fingertips. It's just a way to expand your opportunities. A suburban setting will provide the benefits of both an urban and a rural, in that in a lot of cases it's self-contained, so there's that strong sense of community. It could also be just a short commute into a city as well. My daughter is in the middle of the cornfields in Ohio. I mean, literally, as you know, Greg, there's nothing around but cornfields. And she loves it. It's a very self-contained campus with a strong sense of community. And they make everything inclusive on campus. So just a different way to experience college. Size of the school. Could they see themselves in a large university setting with over 15,000 students? Large would be 15,000. Medium would be between 5,000 and 15,000 students. Small would be fewer than 5,000 students. I hate to keep your face. Sounds like my son, my daughter, but you know, my son did go to a school with over 20,000 students. I think 15,000 of them were undergraduate. Different learning experience than my daughter, who's at a school that probably has 1,700 students, which is probably about the size of her high school. Just interesting. And again, this is all about fit. This was a good fit for her. She wanted a smaller setting. He wanted a larger setting. Affordability. College costs are a big concern and a big factor in determining where your students will apply. Now would be a good time to open those lines of communication and discuss the cost of college and how it will be paid for. You can begin a discussion on financial aid with them. And I know Stephanie King. Hi, Steph. We'll be talking about the specifics of financial aid in her presentation. You may also want to consider other expenses in addition to tuition, room and board, such as travel, books, and supplies. Who will pay for those? Do you expect your child to go to work while at college? Just all things to consider. Discuss the learning environment. Where would they be most comfortable, more appealing to them, where could they be most successful? If you attend a large university, you could find yourself in a setting like this. I remember I had an intro to psych class that was over 1,000 students. You know, you can be sitting in especially the intro classes of several hundred students, or if you go to a smaller college, you can be in and both have advantages and disadvantages because these big lectures will break down into smaller lectures, usually with teaching assistants. Sometimes they have a certain focus to them. And here you're engaged with a professor in a smaller setting. They need to, you know, see and experience it for themselves. Majors and fields of interest. Not every college-bound student knows what he or she wants to study before they go off to college, but and if they do know, sometimes they end up changing their major, but the fact of the matter is if they are going into it knowing, say, that they want to be a biology major, then I would explore the biology department in that school and spend some time there and learn about the department and so forth. You know, if they're not sure and they think it may be, you know, the sciences or it may be something else, gee, maybe you want to consider an arts and sciences school, whereas if you started as a biology major but decided, you know, I really want to be a chemistry major, do you have to change schools if you're at a large university doing that? I see a lot of students doing that. Think about the whole school if you have some idea of what you want to study in mind and whether or not you would have to transfer schools if there was something else that interested you. When I say transfer schools, I mean transfer schools within the large university setting. Field of interest. Field of interest, let's say your student was pre-med. And he knew he needed a lot of lab experience to get into med school. Would a large university, because there are so many professors and so many laboratories on campus, offer more opportunities than a college, which is smaller? Well, maybe not necessarily, because large universities will have graduate students. And a lot of times, priorities for lab work are given to graduate students, whereas a smaller college may not have that. You don't really know until they visit the campus. Everybody follow me on that? Was I clear on that? Okay, other things to consider when communicating with your child? Academic, right page. Academic rigor is a very strong factor when it comes to selecting a good fit. You don't want to be you don't want your child at a school that isn't challenging enough, yet you don't want him or her at a school where everything is cutthroat, or as some of the expressions they use, where fun goes to die, anything like that. Campus life and activities. Do they want a school with an active Greek life? Sororities and fraternities. What percentage of the students are in fraternities and sororities? Are they inclusive when it comes to throwing parties? Do kids stick around on campus for the weekends, or do they go home? A lot of schools have a reputation of being commuter schools. These are the kinds of things you have to think about. Is there a big sports culture at the school? Are they Division I, II, and III? Is that important to your child? What about clubs? Do they offer a wide variety? If they wanted to make up their own club, would they be able to, you know, come up with their own club? And how difficult would that be to get started? For sports, you know, if they've met their NCAA requirements in terms of male and female sports, sometimes students will, you know, start up a club, or there'll be a club that exists on campus, and that particular club will actually compete with teams from other schools. So it could be a club, but it could be competing against other teams. Also, at the beginning of the school year, a lot of schools offer club fairs. And at the club fairs, they have representatives. It's usually held in, you know, like in a gymnasium, or, and they'll have representatives from the different clubs where the students can actually go around and shop the different clubs and see what they want, you know, what their interests are and where they want to spend their extracurricular efforts. For a large university, clubs are a way of making a large campus smaller. Residential living. What percentage of the students live on campus? Are freshmen mixed in with seniors? Are you guaranteed housing throughout the all 4 years of college? Can you get a single room? Hi. Are the handouts there? Okay. Take a second. Residential living, what percentage of the students live on campus? Are freshmen mixed in with seniors? If your child has a roommate issue, my son did, you know, how good is the school on reacting to that? These are all things to consider. And again, that's all included in the handout package. Here's one where people don't give enough attention, and this is very interesting to me, Career Center. Does the Career Center offer workshops on resume writing, cover letters, and interviewing? Do companies come and actively recruit on campus? You know, all throughout the years in college, they're going to have to find internships during the summer. Those internships set you up, if you're, you know, planning on working after college, they set you up for that next job. And it's interesting because I work with students on their college admissions essays, and then they get into the colleges and they go to college, and then they'll come back to me after and say, listen, I'm applying for jobs. Do you think you can help me with my resume? These are the things I've done over the years, cover letters and so forth. And I'll say, just curious, did you go to the Career Center? And they don't even know that the Career Center exists. They don't use the Career Center. And I've read lots of articles that, you know, just tell me all the time how much money colleges are sinking in to their career centers, because, you know, if you're going to be paying all these bucks, you want to make sure you're getting something at the other end of it. So career center, critical, critical thing to check out. Campus safety. I included in the packet a whole list of questions. Not a lot of parents think about it. Some do. You know, there are a whole host of questions, and you can always visit the campus safety office when you go to visit schools. Is the school in a rough part of town? If so, is the campus gated? Do security cars drive frequently through campus? Do the residence halls have an access control system where you can get in with a card if you live there? By law, colleges are required to have campus safety protocols in place, but you can take it one step further by visiting campus security when you visit the campus. Again, I think on page 10 in the handout, there are a whole list of questions for security. Again, the key to everything I've just discussed is to have an open discussion with your children. And by doing that, it'll empower them to search for colleges that reflect their needs, talents, interests, and personal preferences. From there, let them take the lead. Addressing these questions now will help them hone in on a list of schools that might interest them. Everybody good so far? Moving on? Okay. In addition to communicating with your child, the second thing you can do is provide support as they develop their list of colleges. We have juniors, we have sophomores. Sophomores, don't be shy. Go visit colleges now. You can start. Juniors, if they haven't visited colleges now, I recommend they start the whole formal process. And if they're not ready to do the formal process, which they really should be at this point, wake them up Saturday morning and take them out. Look where we live. You know, we live in an area where we have all these kinds of opportunities around us. Go out to the country, show them a school in the country. You know, drive into Boston, show them a school in Boston. Show them large, show them small. It's all within our reach, and it's easily doable. That will get them psyched. That will get them start researching schools. That will get them ready to start going on formal visits. And then what you have to do to provide support is you have to be able to allocate the time to take them to the information sessions and the campus tours, and maybe even arrange overnight stays. This is all done through the admissions office. Okay. I think I jumped ahead of myself. Timing your visit is very critical to getting the full college experience. Obviously, what happens, unfortunately, a lot of times is when your students are on vacation at school, sometimes the colleges that they want to visit are on vacation as well. But, you know, ideally you want to go when the college students are not on vacation. You don't want to go when they're studying for exams or even before they're studying for exams, perhaps not even after they're done with exams, depending on their mood. But you've got to really consider the time when you go visit. I know a lot of kids who travel across the country and end up going Thanksgiving weekend, and I've had to say to people over the years, you know, why are you going Thanksgiving weekend? Nobody's there Thanksgiving weekend. So definitely something to think about. When your child is at the school, have your child talk to students with different majors. Read the local newspaper. See what the big issues are. See, you know, is there some kind of political slant on this campus? Would they be comfortable with that slant? What are the opinions of all the big things going on? Eat the food there. Visit the parts of campus that are important to them. For example, again, if it's research, check out the lab facilities. If it's sports, check out the athletic center. Encourage them to sit in on classes. When you go on your college visits, usually admissions office will have a list of classes that are available for parents and students to sit in on. And of course, make sure to catch some of the fun that's going on there. Okay, again, other ways to provide support: attend college fairs and encourage your child to meet college reps when they visit their high school. Has anyone here been to one of the college fairs? So you've seen its representatives from the different schools who come and provide information. Always great to take your student to that. Usually the people who attend the fairs are admissions office personnel. So always great to go to that, and great for your student to sign in and show his interest in that particular school. Encourage attendance with visiting reps at their high school. Have you heard about that from your high schools, where representatives have come and your students sign up? Wonderful, then we'll move ahead. Additional ways to provide support: attend financial aid events and research ways to finance college. Again, I'll just touch on this lightly, but financial aid events. Programs like these provide free assistance to families of students applying to college who need help filling out the FAFSA form. The FAFSA is a free application for financial aid. Financial aid is money that helps pay for college. By filling out the FAFSA form, students have access to grants, scholarships, loans, and work-study programs. And again, Stephanie will cover that. Support your child's interest in different schools by making sure you gather the facts about what a particular college will cost. Then start researching ways to finance their education. The more you read now, the less overwhelmed you'll be later. Am I okay time-wise? Okay. Okay, research schools and provide options. There's a wealth of information out there about every college. What you have to do is just figure out the way that works best for you and your child. There's information on their website, on college navigation websites, in admissions packets, articles, books like the FISC Guide to College, blogs, online forums, and so forth. And again, as I mentioned earlier, on page 3 of your handout, you'll see a list of all the different websites. Yes? It's something that'll actually help you navigate your way through college once your student expresses an interest, and I'll explain that in a sec. Like, one of them is on, here, I was just gonna go into it, College Board, which is where they sign up for the SATs. There's actually something on there called Big Future, And Big Future helps ask some of these questions, and they can actually plug in their information, and it'll actually help them navigate, you know, their way through a list of colleges, and will actually help them. If your student school offers Naviance, which I'll explain in a minute too, that's another college navigation website. There are plenty of them, and I'll explain.
So in other words, they'll generate lists of schools that might be compatible
with your child's design. Exactly. Exactly. Does anybody want to?
Just based on the interest and when they have scores, there's scores.
Right.
Like what's a reach school, what's a definite, what's a...
Which I'm going to get. Actually, I'll be going into that, which is what I'm going to discuss next. Understanding the requirements for admission. Okay. You can encourage your child to look at the statistics. One of the requirements for admission is understanding, you know, looking at past classes of freshmen who were accepted. So what you're doing is they're looking at their standardized test grades and their GPA. If your child's school doesn't offer Naviance, which I'll explain in a second, you can find this on the college's website. They'll tell what their average, you know, GPA of the accepted students were and so forth. You can find it in college guides like the FIS Guide to College or the Princeton Review. You can also find these stats on websites like US News and World Report, College Data, Parchment.com, numerous ways. And again, that's on the list that I provided. Have your student look at his GPA and his test scores and see where he falls in relation to those accepted students. That's what that's all about. Naviance, everybody familiar with Naviance? No? No? Yes, 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 yes. Okay. Many high schools across the country use Naviance, and if your high school, your student's high school doesn't use it, don't worry about it. But I'll just explain it very, very quickly for those who have students who do use it. One of the features of, I guess what you could say is Naviance is another college navigation website. Okay, that looks like a whole bunch of information on a page, but let me just explain briefly what this is. This happens to be the scattergram page. Naviance is something that's utilized by a particular high school so that you can compare your student can compare himself against other students from his high school who applied to a particular college. That's a mouthful. Let me know if I'm not being clear here. Okay, so what this is just a random page I took off with, you know, no name. I think the name of the student is Johnny Quest, and it's Naviance Succeed High School. So it's a history of students who applied to American University from Naviance Succeed High School from the years 2010 to 2014. And what this does is this enables your child, Johnny Quest, you're the only one who's going to see Johnny Quest's stats, and you and your child, in relation to other students. Here's Johnny Quest, represented as the circle. I'm sorry, this is the only thing online without, you know, using someone's personal information. The vertical axis represents GPA. The horizontal is SAT scores, and this can be changed, and you can submit if your child's taken the ACTs, ACT scores. The green squares represent students over the past 4 years from American, you know, for American University who applied and were accepted. The red X's means they were rejected. This is just a quick way to get an idea of where your son or daughter falls in relation to other kids from his school who are applying to this particular university. So in this instance, this is one way of determining target, safety, and reach schools, which Brianna just mentioned. In this instance, Johnny Quest is here, which means there's a whole cluster of students here, and his GPA seems to be pretty much in there. His, you know, his SAT scores seem to be pretty much in there. I would say for Johnny Quest, this was really a target school for him. If this circle were down over here and his GPA and his SATs were lower, this particular school would be a reach for him. If his circle was way up there, did you catch that? If his circle was way up there, then it's pretty, you know, he's far exceeded the standards for the school. So that would be considered a safety school for him.
This presupposes that the schools use about an equal weight to SAT scores and their GPAs?
Every school will tell you something different. Some schools are no test schools where they won't even look and you don't even have to submit SATs. It's really the individual school. Yes, This does, excuse me, for the purposes of naviance, this just is a quick way to do it, saying that forgetting everything else, but schools will tell you, they take a holistic approach. Everything else aside, just to give, you know, just to put some metrics to it, to give it some numbers, this GPA, these standardized test scores are going to put you in this positioning for your school. It's not accurate, you know? I mean, you know, some schools, and I'm not saying this to alarm anyone or anything, but let's say the student far exceeded the standards for the school. A school may even reject them and say, you know what, he's not going to come here. He's just using this to have an acceptance or something like that. So nothing is a sure bet. I'm sorry to say, it's a crapshoot, you know? But this is, the purpose of this is to just give you a quick way to look at some guidelines for where they stand. Short of that, you can go to the college's individual websites. You can go to these other websites where they'll tell you what the stats are for accepted students. And you can sort of help your child position himself and say, gee, you know, your ACT is full within this range. This you've got a good shot at this school. Your GPA is right in line with it. This is just a quick way of utilizing Naviance by looking at a chart like this and saying, you don't know what the story is here. It's not giving you enough information. I'm sorry to dissect it, but I mean, did they apply early decision? Are they a legacy? None of that is reflected on here. Really, you know, you don't know much more than that. Early decision can affect, you know, the way, you know, whether or not someone is accepted. So it's just to give you a general idea of where your child stands. Is that answer? Okay. Any other questions on this? I know this is a very crowded page. You should see what the, I deal with a lot of students, and I'm sure University of Massachusetts is like this too. But when you look at the University of Connecticut page too, it's like, you know, it's all over the place. So I tried to give you a fairly clean one. All right, I'll find that later. If your child's school does not use Naviance, help them look up admission stats for their schools of interest or encourage them to set up an appointment with their school counselor to discuss colleges and attend. Don't be shy about, you know, if your child's going to meet with the school counselor, invite yourself in and sit in on the meeting. From there, again, you encourage them to come up with a list of the safety, the target, and the reach schools. Everybody clear on safety, target, and reach schools? There's no rule that dictates how many colleges your child should apply to. I wouldn't recommend applying to a lot of schools because it's time consuming, it's costly. It bothers me if the students apply to a school and they're not even interested in the school because it's, you know, it's taking away opportunities from other students. But eventually they're gonna have to make a decision, and if they have, you know, 10 acceptances from very similar schools, why clutter their mind with that at the end of the process? I mean, you really wanna try to find the right fit and be as precise as possible when you're, you know, submitting, when they're submitting all these applications. You don't wanna make the decision making harder at the other end of it. My suggestion, if anyone asks, is to apply to a few schools from, you know, each category. School counselors may give you a different idea. I typically will say apply to 3 target, 3 safety, and 3 reach schools. But you may hear differently from school counselors. There's a lot of work involved with all of that as well. Back to understanding the requirements for admission, has everyone heard of SAT-2 or subject tests? You know, I am not hearing about schools using them as much as they used to, but some schools do require, especially engineering programs, that students take at least 2 SAT-2 tests or subject tests. You know, if your student is considering engineering, typically they like that to be a science SAT-2 and a math SAT-2, but not all schools will specify that. Other requirements, if your child is being recruited as an athlete, make sure you go with him to talk to his or her coaches early and often. If possible, go to the NCAA website to learn about eligibility and recruiting rules. If you have a theater major, students may be required to submit to audition or to send an audition tape. For art majors, they may be required to submit a portfolio of their artwork. For musicians, they may be required to submit recordings of their music. Make sure they keep files, build portfolios, record their performances, and keep track of whatever it is, all their parts in a play or whatever their performances were. Okay, I'll get through this quickly. I know we're good, we're okay? Okay, encourage timely admissions testing and preparation. At this point, juniors hopefully will have taken some of the, you know, standardized tests. You want to get those in as early as possible so that once you have all this information in, that's how you can determine the type of school you'll be applying to. Encourage your student to take SAT 2 or subject tests, which we just discussed. Encourage challenging courses and interesting electives for senior year. Colleges like to see that you're challenging yourself. They don't want to see you getting just all A's in regular classes. They want to see maybe a B in a class, you know, an honors class or an AP class. Encourage your child to take AP courses and exams. You know, have them talk to their teachers about how to take those tests. Usually, of course, those tests happen in May of every year. And encourage a rigorous curriculum and the importance of maintaining good grades. Where are my summer options? Explore summer options. Summer is a great time to explore interests and learn new skills. Colleges look for students who pursue meaningful summer activities. Help select meaningful extracurricular activities. These activities should be ones that showcase their character and or their talent. Gather a list of all of your child's activities, awards, and honors. As again, I'm always good to do, whether you have a sophomore, whether you have a freshman, make sure they keep an active file of everything that they have been involved in, because when it comes time for the applications, if they're going to format a resume, suddenly they're scrambling. When did you do this? When did you perform in this? When did you win this award? Keep a file, or encourage your students to keep a file of everything they'll have. They'll have to spell it all out on their applications, and I highly, highly recommend they have a resume, which I'll explain in a second. But keep a file of everything right now. I cannot tell you how many times I've had even friends calling me saying, do you remember when my daughter appeared in this, or do you happen to have the program for this? Keep track of everything. Encourage your child to format this into a resume. Once they do that, it'll show what kind of applicant they are. For example, if you participated in one activity for all 4 years of high school, let's say for the school newspaper you started out as a writer, and then you progressed to editor of a particular section of the paper. Let's say it was the food section of your school newspaper. Then you became, you know, the chief editor of the newspaper. That shows leadership. That shows progression. That's, you know, what could be formatted on an essay and look great. If you happen to be part of a fundraising organization and you've stuck to that organization, you've done a lot within that organization for all 4 years, that shows a level of commitment and that you want to make a change. These resumes showcase who you are, and on the college application, it's a chance for you, there's an opportunity for you to upload additional information, which even though they ask for a lot of this information in the application itself, sometimes you're limited in terms of the words of things you can say. While you want to be courteous to the reader, it's just a great opportunity. An essay is also great because if they're going to, on an interview, it's very impressive, and I encourage all the students who I work with whom I work to have a resume handy. If you're going to an interview, hand your interviewer a resume. It helps them stay focused, and so they'll be able to talk about the things if they're asked questions. You know, they'll have that in front of them, but it always impresses the interviewer. So strongly, strongly recommend having a resume. No format to the resume except that it looks professional. Again, I don't like to talk about other kids. It's not, you know, it's not professional, but in terms of my own kids, my daughter had interesting summer activities, so she decided to have a whole category of her summer activities. My son took a lot of different languages, so he had a different category for languages. So tailor it to your students' strengths. Make sense? Okay. And encourage your children to start college applications when they're made available in late summer. Again, the application essays for parents of juniors are available now. They're not available for them to fill in online. That won't be available till August. But they just revamped one of the essay questions. They changed up one of the essay questions on the Common App. But they're there so your students can start working on their college essays over the summer. And I've provided that on the last page of the handout. Okay, and then I'm going to go through this quickly. The third task you have as parents is to help your children set realistic expectations. Okay, how much time will they, you know, allocate to their college research? They've got to come up with, devote, what, 3 or 4 hours a week? Let them come up with it. How are they going to go about doing it? Affordability, can your student afford to attend the school, he is considering? You know, maybe an option again is to go to a community college for 2 years and then attend a regular school. Distance, I mean, how do they feel about being so far from home? You know, do they realize they're not going to make it to Aunt Sally's 75th birthday if they're halfway across the country? Academic rigor, we discussed that. Parental expectations, what do they expect from you as parents? Do they want you to sign them up for their standardized testing? Or are they going to do that themselves? Who's going to pay for it? Who's going to pay for all the college applications if they want to send out, you know, 20 college applications? How many schools will they apply to? Strategies for applying to college. Just want to finish up because I know I don't want to take away from others' times. What about applying early? If they consider applying early, can they complete their standardized testing and their applications in time to apply early? Are their chances of getting in greater if they apply early? These are questions you can ask the individual schools. What I've tried to do tonight is to provide you with some tools and techniques for empowering your children. Hopefully you'll consider some of these techniques as you help them navigate their college selection process. Remember, there are many great colleges out there that are going to be a great, great fit for your kids, and they will get into college and they will be successful. Your role is to empower them, support them, and help guide them on their journey. Thank you.
Good evening, and my name is Stephanie King. I'm Director of Student Financial Services here at BayPath. I work with students and families every day to help finance their education here at BayPath, whether it's undergraduate or graduate level work. Financing cost of higher education is very important. Many families, you know, wonder how can we help our child through school? What should we be looking for financial aid? The part of the presentation tonight that you've already heard, communication and setting realistic goals and expectations. Communication through the financial aid piece is very important. You want to make sure that your child is aware of what financial things have to happen for applying for financial aid. And you want to set realistic goals. If you know a particular school that they're interested in, and it's a school that, you know, has a very high sticker price, you want to go through the financial aid process, but that might be a reach school for your child as well. What I would recommend for parents that are, their child is a junior or even a sophomore in high school at this point, it's not too early to think about planning for paying for college. Now is the time to start looking at that. Even if your child is not sure which schools that they're looking at this point, you do want to take a look at some of the resources that are out there to determine how we'll pay for the college expenses, whether the student is going to commute from home or whether they're going to reside on campus, whether it's within a short distance from home or it's across the country. You want to start looking at your finances. You know, could you set up a payment plan per month with the university or college that your child attends? Would you be taking on some loan debt to help finance your child's education at a particular college or university? So these are some of the questions that you do want to start taking a look at as you go through the process. Each school will have different deadlines to apply for financial aid. They may have different applications that are required to be submitted, and so forth. I recommend for parents, and again, bring your child into this process, is to create a spreadsheet of each and every school that they're interested in applying to. Take a look at what applications are required at each and every school. What are deadlines? Some may have early deadlines. For instance, maybe February 1st. Some schools might have rolling deadlines where students can submit applications all through maybe part of the summer. So you do want to take a look at which schools require what, and you want to keep track of what applications have been submitted and when did you submit them. Okay? You do want to make sure that you beat the earliest deadline for any application process. So again, if particular schools are looking for a financial aid application, you want to make sure that you get that application completed. Some of the handouts that you have tonight are from the federal government, some of the federal aid resources that are available, some of websites. The financial aid application for all students who are looking to apply for federal student aid is through the federal government, the FAFSA form, or what's called the Free Application for Federal Student Aid, or FAFSA. There's a lot of acronyms in higher education, especially in financial aid, that we use. FAFSA is one of them. But this information sheet that you have just really talks about the different federal aid programs that students can apply to. There's also what's called the college board, the profile form. Some schools will require that. Some schools will not require that application. They'll only require the FAFSA form. Here at Bay Path, we just require the FAFSA application. But if we do need additional information, we do notify students of that as they go through the application process. The process for your financial aid, when you complete the application itself, FAFSA, or you might have to do the profile form. FAFSA is completed as soon as January 1st rolls around for that next academic year. So if your child is a junior right now, it would be January of their senior year in high school is when you want to start the process for financial aid. You can estimate information because you might have to turn in applications very quickly before you even have your tax returns completed. So it is important that you keep a lot of these documents together. There are what's available on college and university websites that we're now mandated to have. It's what's called a college cost calculator. That calculator will give you an idea somewhat of what financial aid the student might be qualified for, whether it's merit aid or athletic aid, need-based financial aid grants, or student loan programs, or possibly a work-study program where they can work on campus. Each school will have their net price calculator available. It will give you an idea of what expected costs there are associated with going to that particular college or university, what your child might be eligible for in the way of a breakdown of grant and scholarship aid from the university itself, from the federal government, or from the state, in addition to student loans or work study programs. We'll also indicate to you what your out-of-pocket balance would typically look like for that first academic year. Some of the questions that you might want to ask a financial aid office as you are looking at different schools and you're going to an open house and you're meeting with admissions representatives and financial aid representatives is that you want to ask if my child is offered a particular scholarship or grant from the college or university itself. If they're offered that for first year, is that always renewable thereafter? Or are there certain conditions that have to be set forth? Maybe they have to maintain a certain grade point average to have their academic scholarship renewed each year, or there might be just something that the college provides just to first year incoming students, and then that fund is no longer available to upperclassmen. So you'd want to make sure that you ask a lot of questions. What is the typical financial aid award consist of? What is your average financial aid package to your students? Does the aid stay consistent all 4 years or does it change? Again, you don't want to be caught short while you're doing financial planning and thinking that all 4 years your child's going to be eligible for that same aid package. The other question you might want to ask is the tuition costs. Typically, what are your tuition room and board fee costs each year? Do they increase 3%? Do they increase 5%? What kind of typical increases do you see? And then also, does the school offer or increase the aid package based upon the increase in tuition? So some of those questions you do want to ask as you're looking at the school your child is interested in or schools that they're interested in. You want to ask these questions as you are going through the process. You want to view each college website to take a look at all their financial aid information, their admissions information, other important like career information that they are putting out there. So you'll know exactly where you stand with those types of situations for your child. The financial aid process, depending on the school that your child goes to, will be handled by each particular school. All students can complete the FAFSA application. That we know is a given. However, each school may require additional applications as you go forward. There are what's called College Goal Sundays or FAFSA Day Sundays, usually through the months of January and February throughout the country. And you can get one-on-one assistance with completing the FAFSA. Financial aid offices might offer some workshops that help you go through the FAFSA process. There may be some financial aid workshops offered by the high school that your child's attending. I encourage you to go to those as well. They'll go into more depth about completing the FAFSA application, possibly the profile form through the College Board, the different types of financial aid that the student can be eligible for. Again, whether it's granted and scholarship aid directly from the institution or from the federal government, does have some grant aid programs available. Student loans, as you've heard in the media, student loans and the concern about having loan debt, that is part of a financial aid package. Students can determine if they'd like to accept or decline part of their student loan programs. The national average is about $27,000 in student loan debt upon graduation from a four-year institution. So you'd want to take a look at that as well. You also want to encourage your child to apply for private outside scholarships, whether it's from your local community or it's nationally. You can check one with the high school guidance counselor's office to see what information they have available for scholarships. You can also check out the schools, the individual college or university's website to see if they have some information that they promote. Here at Bay Path, we do. We have a specific web page on our web under financial aid that we have a list of scholarship links that students can take a look at. Also through the federal government site, through fastweb.com is another one where the student puts in a profile of themselves and we matched up to scholarships. As a junior, it isn't too early to actually start looking at some of these things. Definitely by senior year, you want to start applying for private scholarships. Another question you do want to ask a financial aid office is how they treat outside scholarship assistance. Some colleges will allow that scholarship to come in and be applied directly against the out-of-pocket balance that you owe at that institution. Some other institutions might take a portion or all of what they've provided in a grant from that institution and reduce it or eliminate it altogether based upon the amount of that scholarship aid that's coming from an outside source. So again, you don't want to be caught short by thinking, we have the financial aid package from this particular college, and now my child has received a $1,000 outside scholarship, and you're thinking that's going to automatically reduce your bottom line figure to go to that institution, and then find out later that the college is going to reduce their own institutional grant fund by that same dollar amount or by a portion. So you want to make sure that you have that question answered as you go into looking at a particular school and the process. Typically, the financial aid and admissions office will work closely together as you go through this process. We'll work hand in hand to make sure that the admissions pieces are done, and then the transition with all the financial aid happens as well. Financial aid has to be done every single year. So after your first year, you're kind of an expert as you go through the process. I do recommend you take it a step-by-step process as your child is applying to colleges. January 1st is that application processing time for financial aid. Again, if you have to do the profile form through the College Board, that application can be very early. That could be January 1st as well for early admission decisions. You want to then complete the application for financial aid. Once you do that and make sure that all the documents are submitted through financial aid, then you need to wait to hear back from the school or schools that your child is interested in. So usually around beginning of March, the first week of March, or maybe even the end of February, financial aid award letter notifications start coming to your home. Again, referring back to the earlier presentation, hearing about communication, you need to make sure that you and your child are communicating, especially when you get that financial aid award package in the mail. It's addressed to the student. You want to make sure that your child isn't just taking that and throwing it in their room somewhere. I mean, every year I always have a parent call and say, my child never got their financial aid award package. And we say, well, we mailed it out 3 weeks ago. And lo and behold, it's in the child's, you know, possession. They just never shared it with mom or dad. So you want to make sure that the communication's there. You do want to look at the aid packages that you receive in the mail. You don't necessarily want to jump on the aid package that offers the most in financial aid, because you want to look at an assessment. You want to take a look at, and again, create a spreadsheet. Look at each school. Write down, what are the costs? What is tuition? What's room and board if they're residing on campus? What are your fees? Maybe they have a lab fees. Maybe some schools don't have any type of fees other than tuition, room and board. Maybe there's student government fees. Maybe there's technology fees. You want to figure all of that information out and then subtract out the financial aid to really figure out what is your bottom line figure as you're going through this process. Because again, the school that offers the most in financial aid might be the most expensive, and your out-of-pocket balance might be higher than at another institution. So you want to take a look at all of the factors, not just the financial. You want to take a look at the best fit for your child, where they find themselves most comfortable, all the different things that Sue went over tonight about picking that right college for your child. And finances, yes, are a big part of that, but you wanna be careful about that process as you go through it. The financial aid, as I said, is year to year. If you have special circumstances that are not reflected on the applications themselves, for instance, if the school only requires you to complete the FAFSA application, that application is basically only looking at numbers. We're looking at tax information, such as your income, the number in your family. Do you have any assets that you might own, like a second home or anything like that? Not your home, not your retirement savings that you're putting aside. Anything else that you might have in some type of assets that you can liquidate. That information is what's going to be reported on FAFSA. So if you have financial circumstances that you want to have the financial aid office be aware of, you need to have that conversation with us, basically. We want to make sure that we are aware that maybe your income that's reflected on the FAFSA application is not really truly what your normal income looks like. Maybe there was there was overtime for a particular parent that 1 year, and they had much more income than they normally do on a tax, on any type of tax year. So you want to have those conversations, even if it's after the fact, it's after you've committed to that particular college or university. You do want to have that conversation, because there may be additional aid that the college can actually offer you based upon those circumstances. So again, we're just looking at number information. We're not looking at maybe that there are special circumstances that you may have within your family. And just as in closing, I just want to make sure that families are researching, you're doing a lot of reading, to take a look at where you should be at this point in time. If your child is a sophomore, it's not too early, I can't stress, to start reading the information that I had as handouts tonight. There's a lot of different web links there. Start now to really get yourself familiarized with what is financial aid, what's gonna be our process, and taking a look at your finances. You know, could we, if we had to, handle a $500 a month payment plan to help our child go to school. If we had to take out a loan, could we handle that? There are some links that I provided you on some of this information tonight that has some calculators through the federal government site. So if you decide as a parent, we're going to take out a parent loan to help finance our child's education, what if we needed to borrow $15,000? What would that look like as of right now, based upon interest rates and so forth, for a monthly payment, over a period of 10 years? Typical repayment for parents on a federal parent loan is about 10 years. So you'd want to take a look at that information. You want to start planning financially now as to where you may be at to help your child go to school. Again, whether it's at a community college, a state university, or a private institution, where you might want to see that information to go through. Okay, and I do want to turn it over to Don Bryden, who can give you some additional information regarding the admissions process and other important information.
My name is Dawn Bryden. I'm the Associate Dean here at Bay Path University, and I'm just going to close up with a couple of interactive little things and then a couple of tips. I did have a PowerPoint all set for you, a little Prezi, but Susan went through so much of it that I didn't want to repeat all of this. So I kind of skinnied it down to what's most important to me. How's that sound? Good? Grab your pencil, your paper, okay? Think about when you were going to college. What was it that you were looking for in a school? And go ahead and write that down. I'll give you 2 seconds. It shouldn't, if it was a long time ago, it might take you a little bit longer to think about that. So over the past 10 years, I've had the great fortune to meet with thousands of students and interview with them. And one of the biggest things that I talk to them about is, give me the top 3 things that you're looking for in a college. Right then and there, I know if we're going to have a good conversation or if I need to pivot my conversation and help them, advise them to help them find something else that might work for them instead. Number one, academic program is what they're looking for. So your daughter or son will probably say academic program. Maybe they won't. But for the most part, this is what I'm hearing. Number two, cost, affordability. So whoever said cost over here, they say cost and affordability is number two. And number three, interaction with their faculty. They want to make sure that they can have those interactions with their faculty that they're looking for and get the answers that they need. So I think when Susan talks about communication, it's a two-way conversation, two-way street. You need to find out what your students are looking for is the top priority when you're looking for a college. I like to tell my story because it's kind of a failure. It was not anything of when you look at these top three things. I was a first-generation college kid. My dad and mom did not go to college, blue-collar workers. So I was at the, you know, mercy of my guidance counselor. I went to a suburban high school and pretty much was funneled right to the state system. My guidance counselor said, "What would you like to do?" And I said, "Biophysics. I loved physics." Yeah, I pass out at the sight of blood. Failure number one, didn't go after the program I really needed to pursue. Number two, cost. I also looked at Simmons College. After I looked at UMass, I went to Simmons. I really wanted to go to a women's college. I thought that was my calling. The price tag really scared me. So being a first generation college kid, I didn't know the resources to go to and ask about to make that happen. So number two, failure, cost for me. I ended up going to UMass because of the cost. Number three, interaction with faculty. I ended up settling for a school that, you know, as Susan showed, with thousands of students in the auditorium, I was just a number. I was a small fish in a big pond. So strike one, strike two, strike three. And it'll happen, unfortunately, to many, many students, just like myself. And it's, at the end of the day, it's basically your students' decision to follow that passion, make those decisions, and you have to take a step back and be the guide, but not, you know, pulling the student along either at the same time. Fast forward, now my son is 22, and I was in your seat many years ago, 6 years ago, and with all of the knowledge that I had, would he listen to me? No. Right? First of all, he's a boy. He's not going to listen to mom, no matter what the profession was. But that was okay. But again, I said, what is it that you're looking for? Where do you want to go? And I let him make those decisions, which was really important. So strike one, strike two, strike three, I was out. I picked myself up afterwards and I said, okay, this is what I need to do. I need to reevaluate and reassess. And my parents were there to help me, which was great. So I've got a couple of tips for you. Number one, do your homework. Like Stephanie was saying, like Susan was saying, we're gonna go to the College Navigator for National Center for Education Statistics. So if you go into Google and you Google iPeds cool, you can write this down, iPeds, I-P-E-D-S, and then cool, C-O-O-L. This College Navigator will give you insight on any school in America. And I had people ask me about international schools. We didn't go too far. They were asking about Bahamas, Bermuda. So who wants to share a school that they went to? Anybody?
Union College.
Which one?
Union College in Schenectady.
Union. Mm-hmm. Very good. Thank you. We'll pull up our friend Union in Schenectady. And this will tell you lots of great, rich information. It tells you about graduation rates, it tells you about faculty, it tells you about financial aid, net price, enrollment, number of graduates, programs and majors, varsity athletics, accreditation, default rates, lots. And so for a parent who's starting this process, you're going to talk to your son or daughter, find out what that short list is going to be, and start doing some homework on your own to find out whether or not this is going to be the right fit for him or her. I love this website. It talks about lots of different statistics. And of course, you go onto those websites of each college and they're going to paint the prettiest picture. The leaves are all, you know, golden and all the students are smiling. But behind the scenes, this is what's happening. It could be total chaos. We hope it isn't, but it could be. So this is my number one tip for you, iPeds cool. Number two, as your student is looking at colleges, he or she is going to go to some national college fairs. There's one usually in the fall at Western New England University. We just had one at the Eastern States Exposition. Thousands of colleges, thousands of kids. Small amount of window time to get through all of those schools. So unlike my son, with my stepdaughter, I made labels. On the labels, I put her name, her date of birth, her major that she was looking for, her athletics or activities, and I would go up to each of the table and they have these inquiry cards and I just smacked the label right on the inquiry cards. You don't have to take time and sign everything, okay? Tip number two, make your labels, get ready for that process. You can zip right through all of those colleges, the ones, the highlighted ones that are on her list with her, express interest. It'll save you a ton of time and your hand won't hurt at the end of the night either. So tip number two, make those labels. Tip number three, make sure you go out to visit the school. Very key, because whether it's an impromptu visit or it's a program that the school was putting on, whatever that looks like for you and your family, definitely go out and look at the school. As Maya Angelou would say, I would sit in a conversation and go to a presentation. I might not remember what was being said, but I remember how I felt. So as you walk off of that campus after that visit, how is it that you were treated? How is it that your student was treated? Did they feel welcomed? And this is talking about that fit. You have to feel like you belong and this is the right fit for you, because if you don't have that in your gut, you won't be happy, you won't be successful. So to me, you could show a student 10 different schools, they could all cost the same, but if you don't feel comfortable going to those schools, you don't feel comfortable sitting in those chairs. On our tours, we make sure our students and their families sit in all of our chairs, visit all of the rooms, visualize yourself as a student. If that's not the right fit for you, then we need to help that student find the right fit. And that's what our job is. So, We talked about the acronym of COOL. Thank you, Stephanie. You said lots of acronyms. The spreadsheet idea is a fantastic idea. Keep up with that spreadsheet. Add columns to different pieces that are most important to you, and you can see visually. I'm a visual person. My son, we had a little bin, okay, filed, top schools, okay. We kept everything in those bins because guess what? Once you put your name on those labels and put them on those cards, my stepdaughter's pile is like this in a big basket. Okay, that's a nightmare. So make sure you stay organized through the whole process. Don't skip a beat. Make sure you keep track of all of the timelines. Find out if your school is a rolling admission school or if you have a deadline, which is really important, just so that you don't miss anything. And I think that's it for my tips. At Bay Path, we do have rolling admissions. We help hundreds, thousands of students. We have different types of visits that students can go on, overnight visits, personal visits, group visits. Each school will have different types of visits that you can participate in. And I always say, start early. Summertime is great for sophomores and juniors. Continue on, because every time you go to visit a school, you learn something different. And it's just making sure that your student feels more and more comfortable each and every time that they come to campus. It's an investment. So invest your time wisely. Do the research that you need to make happen. Think about my story. Failure, failure, failure. And at the end of the day, as long as your student is happy, then he or she will be happy in the career that they choose. I saw a hand in the back. Yeah, so some schools will have early decision where you have to commit and sign a letter of intent to enroll. Some schools will have early action where you have early action deadlines, say by December 15th. Some schools might say, have your admissions decision by December 15th, secure your spot in the incoming class. Other schools will have rolling admissions, which we will continually accept the applications throughout the process. So I hope that helps. Any other questions? Yep.
So if you go on the website of a particular school and they say that the certain SAT scores and the certain GPA has to be in place for you to have your child enroll, if your child doesn't meet those credentials or that minimum SAT score, does that automatically mean that you should move on to a different school, or is that something that you still have to send it in and they might look at other circumstances?
You know, every school is different. I would say continue on until you get that letter that says, we're sorry, your daughter is not accepted, or whatever that looks like to her. At our school, we do have minimums, but we also have, you know, that gray area. What if the student has an IEP and doesn't test well? What if the student is a first generation, second language is, you know, English is second language, and really has a struggle with the SAT? So we would work and look at other components, maybe bring in the essay, maybe bring in the interview, maybe, you know, ask them for other documents, other letters of recommendation. I wouldn't cross that off right off the bat, but also know that there are also opportunities. If the student would do better served at a community college and then transfer in, that might be a better way to get to that bachelor's degree. Anybody else?
We don't do ACTs, right?
We accept the ACT. Some students do take both.
Yeah, and submit them if you have them, because they do look at them even if they don't require them. You'll
Schools will also offer SAT prep days. We do one in the fall, which is free for women, for girls. But look for schools that might offer SAT prep days as well. And high schools will offer financial aid nights as well. So think about that, attending those financial aid nights at your local high school or SAT prep days. So I think maybe Stephanie might want to come up, and Susan, and if anybody has questions for any of us, we can answer those.
One thing I see a lot with students is they have a college on their radar. It could be something that is not even considered by a lot of other students. And once they share that with their friends, suddenly it becomes the interest of all their friends, and things go in trends. And what was originally their school, their dream school, now becomes something that their whole group of friends, girlfriends, guy friends, whatever, are interested in. And I've seen it happen all too many times. One thing I'd like to encourage, they're gonna share their schools with their friends. They're gonna do that, especially their closest friends. But just a general rule of thumb, less is more. You know, the less they can share with somebody. And I hate to be like that, but you know, if a college is only gonna take two or three kids for a certain school, you know, from a certain school, you know, just try it best as they keep as much as they can for themselves. Don't overshare, that's all. Seen it happen too many times.
That's a good point.